Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the webinar on point of view on SD-WAN and the architectural benefits. My name is Khalid Raza. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Viptela. With me is Musaddiq Thorabi, and I'll have Musaddiq introduce himself.
Hello, everyone. This is Musaddiq Thorabi. I'm the product manager at Viptela. Today, we are having the first part of the two-part series webcast. This is about enterprise network architectures. The second part of the webcast will be on March 16. If you have any questions during the presentation, please put the question in the QA box, and we'll try to address them at the end of the presentation. So I would like to start asking Khalid a quick, this question. What were your starting assumptions and Viptela approach?
So we started Viptela around 2012, but the thought process of this architecture started to brewing around 2011. So the buzzwords around those days and still continue to be in the marketplace is how do I utilize the commodity space that is created for cloud? But at the root of all of these, if you look at it, it's about connecting application to the user regardless of location. As the early networks were built, your locations were predictable. So you're building networks where the data was hosted, serviced to data centers, your exits were created around DMZs, which at times were near the data center. So you're moving from an environment which was centered around data center to an environment which is going to get distributed into cloud. So sort of like centers of data. And from that perspective, we looked at the complexity and the innovation that needed to be in the wide area space. So you needed a flexibility, ubiquitous access, any-to-any connectivity. So those were our starting assumptions. Then we looked at the technologies that were available. So if you look at any traditional wide area environment, the technology that was available was MPLS was dominantly adopted by the enterprise. And in a lot of cases, IPsec was used as a backup. Either they were dual MPLS circuit, IPsec was a tertiary for a complete backup. So the technologies that we looked at that were available to us was IPsec and MPLS. So then the question is, so a little bit about my background working with the large carriers and large enterprise, MPLS got a very serious adoption and very quickly got adopted. So people were willing to outsource their control plane to the carrier in exchange for removing complexity of building these complex wide area networks. So the biggest driver for MPLS was you had connectivity and you can bring any on-net site into this infrastructure. And the driver was a ubiquitous access. Your traffic pattern mandated that you had a lot of site-to-site data transfer. It was over a secure network. Your voice over IP was a driver. Video was a driver. In case of manufacturing and healthcare, your imaging applications was a big driver. Your big manufacturing files was a big driver. So enterprise was attracted to MPLS for that ubiquitous access and no need for complexity inside of their network, but they handed over their control plane. So those were our starting assumption, looking at the problem, and how do you remove that complexity and making that control plane very flexible that it can be inside the MPLS carrier, managed service provider. If a larger enterprise wanted a piece of that control plane, they can move that out. So that was our starting assumption that were needed in the network.
So, Khalid, what were your thoughts on software-defined networking?
So at Viptela, we looked at SDN from a slightly different angle. So if you look at what was the beauty of Internet, the beauty of Internet was the TCP/IP created and complete abstraction layer, which gives you an opportunity to innovate independently at each layer. So that's why Internet has survived the speed and magnitude to scale, diversity of application. So all you needed to do any kind of newer innovation at each layer, you had to have a backward compatibility hook. This is similarly, we looked at it and said, let's look at this whole problem holistically. And each component would have its own independent innovation. So first of all, we looked at orchestration layer. The reason is when we were building networks, we were building networks with defined hardware points. They were part of a defined location, topology. Along comes cloud. You are now extending any element of your network to any arbitrary point. And those pieces required a very efficient orchestration of cloud, because you might be hosting some at Azure, some at Amazon, some in Google Cloud. So that flexibility of moving at the orchestration layer was the first piece of it. So there are a lot of vendors out there that are already doing it. You have tools out there like OpenStack. In OpenStack, you have Ansible, Puppet, Chef doing that orchestration layer. You have public cloud side, things like AWS Cloud Foundation. We have our own tool that you can orchestrate across clouds. So that was the orchestration layer. You can continue to innovate and continue to use tools out there that are available to you. Second piece was the management layer. So from management perspective, we went into management being management, monitoring, provisioning, and troubleshooting. So from monitoring perspective, MPLS links were on the higher end, the cost per bit was a little high, so you wanted the visibility, but in a lot of cases, you don't want to utilize your resources on an MPLS link to getting that fast, high-speed, real-time visibility. So from monitoring purposes, people were monitoring interface state, bandwidth utilizations, and as networks are becoming more intelligent, you want more out of it. You want for more analytics. You need to understand who's utilizing more applications. You need to understand who's going what application at where in the cloud. So you are getting more deeper into the visibility of the application. So you need to collect your more data. And one of the interesting aspects of if you start using commodity internet as an alternative circuit, as a second path to your MPLS, existing MPLS, you can get a lot more real-time data collected for it, and then you can do a lot more analytics, make some intelligent decision, make some capacity planning, provisioning. The next piece that is comes in is provisioning. One of the beauties of SDN, in my mind, was you have a central policy orchestration for it, and then that policy in a lot of segment becomes reusable. So regardless of my location, if there is a retail customers I have, if they have an ATM, regardless of where ATM is, that policy is consistent throughout. So that's a reusable policy. And the benefit of that is you have a better verification of your regulatory compliance. So you're saying, I can verify through a central point that my policy is consistent. So it gives a little better feel of security. You can monitor your compliance regulatory application systems very well. Third was troubleshooting. So we looked at it and says NetOps needs to become more proactive. If you look at NetOps today, it is more reactive. For example, you can profile your applications. You have a certain profile. You say, is it time to increase my bandwidth? Because you don't want your users to be complaining that my performance is going south. The number of users have increased on a location. So this application is utilizing this much amount of bandwidth. So you can do some interesting capacity planning issues. Next thing is, if you start to notice that at a certain site, there are users who are consuming way too much amount of bandwidth or going to some site which have to be quarantined, you have that visibility. So collecting data in real time, getting more visibility, and becoming a lot more proactive. So those for us was the management layer. Then comes one of the main things the MPLS came to solve is the control plane and data plane separation. So if we look at the control plane, we looked at control plane and said, what has caused rigidity? The biggest rigidity was caused by the control plane. Why? Because all your routing algorithms are very distributed. So if I wanted to make a change, if I wanted to alter any policy, and I want to implement my policy goals, I had to come between the adjacency of those two routing elements. So your policy and configuration was very distributed, and every element that was communicating to each other, that policy had to be implemented in the routing plane. So any ACL I wanted to do, any firewalling or any service chaining I wanted to do, I had to come in between on those distributed elements. So, and then control plane was decided how to build your data plane, but that was local to the box. So one of the best things about SDN is about network should not connect with any element without a policy. So your policy puts the network elements in place before it actually connects. So those were the primary assumption. Then transport independent comes in. Then flexibility of the control plane movement comes in, because the policy interface had to be defined into every element of the network before the network connected. Those were things that were very obvious to us. And then the application drivers and the customers asking for those application drivers. And we'll talk about a little bit more on that.
Okay. What are the key applications that are molding enterprise network requirements?
So the key applications that we heard from our enterprise customers, so we started to do this discovery around 2011-12. We were consulting to a major financial. Amir and I were paying our bills through consulting some major financial company. It was in one of the interesting conversations we were in there, one of the comment was made, I want to do site-to-site video. And the bandwidth requirements were on the higher end. And how do I do a site-to-site video? Very interesting example that for that branch of the future, any location does not have a mortgage broker. I should be able to bring that mortgage broker from any close proximity and start to provide that service, because I don't want that customer to walk out of my environment. So a lot of site-to-site high bandwidth connections, real-time voice, real-time video, healthcare. There is a lot of imaging transfers that happen. So those guys are very sensitive to latency. So again, I should be able to build on a per-segment arbitrary topology based on my policies. The only network that was giving me that freedom was MPLS, but I want that similarity over any kind of transport. So I should have that freedom to build that transport. So traffic engineering, if I feel that my network is having some attack, some point in my network, I should be able to quickly pivot my topology and take that to a service chain point. Then cloud. So for different people, cloud has had different feeling around this 2011-12 time frame. But we looked at the aspect of it. We looked at the aspect of SaaS. We looked at the aspect of infrastructure as a service, PaaS. So, and I'll go over those discussion a little bit more. But let me come back to the video. So one of the things that from video, where the branch of the future was, we were talking to our financial customer who we were consulting. They said, look, I do not want this video traffic to trombone through any point if there is a connection between those two sites. It should go direct, the way my MPLS goes. So all the transport should get that direct connection if there is an IP connectivity between them. So your IP layer 3 becomes a transport. So if I trombone through any gateway points, the biggest issue with that is people always point out is latency. Latency is one of the issues. Then it becomes an issue for capacity planning. So this financial customer we were talking to, they had about 5,000 sites, 5,000 branches. Just imagine 8 or 10% of them are having a video conference or a video conversation. You've just unnecessarily burdened your head end just because you put a gateway to take your traffic through those points. Again, the beauty of MPLS was ubiquitous data plane. And for us, that was table stakes. Ubiquitous data plane over an untrusted third-party network, which is internet. So it should be seamless, segmented topology, and all they wanted was only voice video should go peer-to-peer, but the data should be hub and spoke. So that is where your application profiling comes in. So that was obvious to us that people wanted a lot more flexibility than what they had today. Then in one of the biggest deployments Viptela has is a big retail customer. They had a second use case, which was on video surveillance. So when you have video surveillance, there is a lost and found or a theft event in one of the sites in San Jose. They never wanted their San Jose site video to be going to everybody at every location. They wanted to send that video to a 25-mile radius. So on demand, you created a mesh, you created that segment that only those 25-mile radius branches got the identity of the individual who was involved in that event. So
what was obvious to us is the way we've built networks, we've defined policies. Policies are going to get very, very dynamic, and people would like to change them from a central policy point and as quickly to handle their network requirements or policy requirements, what is needed. The other interesting piece was the IT is consistently under pressure from line of business that, hey, I am doing a lot more work in the public sphere. I want to have my team start to utilize this new tool. But IT is under pressure that if they're, that this new company that you're bringing in, this new tool you're bringing, are they following compliance, right? So if you're an IT guy, you want them to follow compliance, but you want only that group of people who've taken the permission to use that particular application in the cloud. So again, through segmented topology, segmented lockdown topologies, you'll be able to give them that freedom that, okay, until the compliance is happening, I'm going to backhaul you. I'll verify if this application passes all our check, compliance checks, or this SaaS application that you've taken from the cloud. Once that is done, I can give you a DIA. But that's just a one click. All your users will log in that right. The segment will
an IT guy. You want it. Them to follow compliance, but you want only.
So the traffic engineer paths. In a lot of cases, I want to trombone traffic through certain points. If I want to do a service insertion, certain segments in my network should not be permitted to go directly. And a lot of this is done over on a common circuit. So I can have internet, MPLS, and LTE for HA reasons, but their topology should remain the same consistently over any kind of network. Then comes the application profiling. Traditionally, how we've used the load balancing, ECMP path, usually on IP destination basis. Now, if you have through DPI, you have visibility, you want to move a certain SLA-based application on a certain path, you can say, okay, my SLA requirements for voice is X. I'm okay if there is a high-end data transfer going on, I can use internet, but as long as the MPLS circuit is available, I want to use voice to use MPLS. I can go deeper and say, based on the requirements that I'm getting on that circuit, if it fulfills my requirement, in certain cases, if my MPLS is having issues, I should seamlessly move that connection to any circuit I want. So I should have that freedom. Now comes the other very big component for us, the driver for SD-WAN or NR implementation, it's cloud. So from cloud perspective, we looked at cloud as three elements. You have software as a service, you have infrastructure as a service, you have platform as a service. So if we would look at it traditionally from software as a service point of view, your software service provider, if you're using Amazon, if you're using Office 365 or using Salesforce, those guys are usually very, very careful about security, compliance, and abiding by all the rules of the compliance. When you move into infrastructure as a service, you want to move your regulatory environment into the infrastructure. Although the web services, Azure, Amazon, those guys provide that layer of security, but in a lot of cases, in a compliance environment, you want that part of your network to be accessible into that infrastructure. But traditionally, a lot of times, they were considered as extension to my data center. Now, if you look at it, again, if that's extension to your data center, you would trombone your traffic through your data center, again, introducing latency and performance. Very simple example. If I have taken infrastructure at Amazon facility in Portland, and I'm in San Jose, if I'm taking my traffic back through Dallas, I'm introducing latency. Now, if I'm able to simply put my network element, orchestrate them in the cloud, and pass that traffic perfectly between the locations to avoid that latency. So infrastructure as a service, I was talking to one of our customers that provides services through the Amazon cloud. They said in certain cases, I want my simply say that everything that is out there is part of my network and it's following all the compliance rules that have been enforced on me. Then platform as a service. From PaaS, there is so much work that is done in .NET infrastructure, Azure. There's a lot of development that happens. Your application developers, and a lot of times, are not security guys. But they are putting that application in the cloud. You want, during a dev and test, you want certain branch segments to go there. But you as a network guy can safely say, look, it's in the public cloud. I can guarantee that my compliance has been fulfilled. When it comes to segment comes in, until my security guy, application development guys have done all the security checks, my infrastructure will continue to protect this and provide compliance to those pieces of the network.
Hello, all. So what we are doing, we are opening up a poll. We want to understand your network environment, and we want to know if video and cloud application are critical for your network. So you can go to the tab that says voting and vote to that question. So Khalid, what impact on current WAN architectures and shift in present and future business needs are happening because of this shift?
So if you look at this, people for redundancy in a lot of cases had a primary MPLS, brought in a second MPLS, and they were able to distribute their traffic across that. Internet in a lot of cases was used as a complete backup. And there were reasons to it. If I look at the current way the MPLS comes in into the network, MPLS is considered as a trusted, secure environment, and they usually end up in your production zones. So the traffic is coming in your production zone. You have these MPLS routes in your network inside data center. You have an optimal return path for it. Usually internet does not come into those trusted zones. They end up in their DMZs. When the internet connections, which are over IPsec, they end up in the DMZs, what happens there in the back end, then you have complex routing topologies to figure out. You have to figure out how you do load sharing across these different segmented environments. So it starts to become a little complex, especially around policy. And a lot of times, if you have those alternate circuits, I was just in a meeting with a customer. They were actually raising that issue that I'm paying a lot of money for my internet bandwidth, but it's being utilized as a backup. So I want to use a complete, have the freedom and flexibility to use it the way I want to use it, use all of my circuits that are available to me. So now again, if the control plane policy is centralized, you would be able to decide that seamlessly, that the control plane policy is there. You decide if it's the MPLS is the best path for what application. You can put it rather than getting into data center complex backend routing flows. Another thing is, again, your line of business guy would get flexibility of saying, I can break out anywhere. I can, in certain cases, your IT guys can say, what if I put these performance hub in certain locations where I can hop you off to the cloud provider? You can go through a direct connect of an MPLS provider. So you, again, are getting into the space where you will get that flexibility and be able to connect the way you would like to connect, not the way that you're forced to connect. So, again, I have repeated this thing a few times. Connecting network is a policy decision. It should not be a topology decision.
All right. Thanks, Khalid. So a couple of other questions that we have seen on the in the Q&A section. One question is, without MPLS, how do you guarantee efficiency in the wide area network?
So I'm not saying without MPLS. I think MPLS is going to be there as a transport, so one of the transports. So your MPLS providers are here to stay. I have a little take how MPLS networks can get evolved, which I'll talk in the end a little bit. But again, MPLS can, you can use MPLS as one of the circuits because one of our partners, Verizon, actually has provided services to a very large financial customer of ours, and they're using MPLS as, and they're augmenting their MPLS offerings with other kind of transport for broadband, LTE for HA. So they're deploying it for agility reasons. If I I don't want my customers to be waiting for a period of time until I have that service there. So you can pick up any type of circuit and provide connectivity, so get the business going. I think MPLS will stay there as one of the transport, and you have the freedom to choose any other transport. You can offload some of your traffic on the MPLS, some on the internet, based on your requirements of the line of business and based on the strict reasons of quality of service, performance, predictable SLA. So we feel that these transports, the MPLS is one of the transport, and that transport will stay and will be used for providing, in certain cases, guaranteed path SLAs if it's needed by the application.
So one more question. How enterprise network teams and service providers can adapt the traditional WAN to support new traffic types?
So from looking at it from slightly different lenses, so how these MPLS providers are evolving, like very simple case. We were working in the early days with one of our customers when Hurricane Sandy hit. So what happened is, in certain cases, you'd be surprised that carriers' last mile circuits are the same. And in that environment, people wanted to bring up their sites as quickly as possible. So LTE became a very important factor of it. Your primary provider can use any broadband circuit that's available to them to create a complete path diversity. So diversity of the path, yet able to provide that ubiquitous connectivity if there is an IP circuit between those elements. So that evolution will happen. Just imagine, I have sites that are purely on MPLS. I'm looking into bringing broadband there, and I have certain locations which I brought up very quickly for it to expand my service in those locations over a broadband. I should have the capability to connect site-to-site MPLS to a broadband through IP transport, making sure my compliance and security is followed. So flexibility of any connectivity should not be hampered by what you have over there, but what you can get at a location. So you can have LTE, you can have MPLS, you can have broadband, as long as there is an IP path between them. And if you look at from HA perspective, the ability of an SD-WAN to use any transport to have and have variety of option on used on a backup basis is what is what an operator desires, that if I have lost a circuit in a hurricane situation, I should be able to bring up anything that provides me connectivity and yet be able to connect to my network seamlessly as it was connecting. Then the other piece of it is the intelligent SLA-based routing. I should be able to decide what circuit is available, what capacity is available, what performance is available, and what is the requirement for my application and to get the most optimal path, certain case most optimal path, certain cases most customizable path. So I should have a complete flexibility in this space. I'd earlier mentioned that I think that MPLS networks are not going to disappear, but I have a slight view on this, which is I think the MPLS networks will transform into more efficient overlays, but they will become a fast lane private network for the larger good. So that infrastructure is there, the availability is there. If you start to extract some of this information from those PE devices, you have a complete built-out infrastructure that can give you guaranteed SLA across that. And most of these MPLS providers also have those connections into Direct Connect. So you have internet circuits, which gives you the optimal performance. You can have MPLS build overlays where PE starts to become more stateless, and it also moves into the SDN virtual PE model, then you can simply connect site-to-site where MPLS is a guaranteed service, internet is the best effort, and there are intelligent ways to utilize both circuit in the most optimal fashion. I'll stop here and open up for questions.
So we have another question, which is regarding with the hybrid SD-WAN deployments, how enterprises have to evolve to address the security concerns.
So actually, you're leading right into my next webinar, because the digitization is actually going to put even more interesting pressure on the security concerns. So if you break this security down from different angles, I'm just going to address this briefly. So from a security perspective, you have data transit security from SD-WAN perspective. So how do you protect your data integrity, confidentiality, non-repudiation, and authentication? That all has to be taken care of from a network point of view. The second is, how do you protect your resources coming in? How do you have visibility into application? How you feel that if application is not behaving a certain way as expected, you will be able to move those flows around. So having deeper visibility, deeper understanding, protecting your resources, protecting your devices, and protecting data in transit from transport perspective is what security is about. And actually, the next webinar that we have on the 16th is about the impact of digitization on security of networks.
One more question. Is the VH device the only device on a remote site, basically replacing the existing WAN device in a site?
So we have multiple flavors of this, and absolutely, VH device is the only device. We are a replacement of a router with much more centralized control. So we have multiple flavors of it. We have a gig, 10 gig, 100 meg, and we have a virtual software as well. So you can, based on your requirements, you can use any of those available flavors. But yes, VH is a full-fledged intelligent router. It talks BGP OSPF on the local LAN. We looked at these issues, and during transitions, it becomes so critical. As I had mentioned, a healthcare customer, in a lot of cases, when you ask your healthcare customers, hey, I have a gateway, or there is a gateway during transition from your full-meshed MPLS to this hybrid WAN, can you go through these gateways? And the answer to us in the healthcare case was a very, very resounding no. Because I have my medical practitioners who are complaining about a 19-millisecond latency. You're telling me to go through a gateway? So from our perspective, it was very obvious that these customers, manufacturing, healthcare, will not accept any latency introduced artificially for your architecture to fulfill that requirement. So then you come into interesting scenarios. You become that edge device which is building SD-WAN, but here it's collected to a site which is also doing traditional MPLS. So that is an underlay element there. Your systems has to be so smart to understand where you can recreate routing loops, how to understand that this route has traversed MPLS, and I do not want, I mean, I'm taking it into overlay. How do you take care of loops? How do you smarter to understand if I've received an OSPF route from a data center versus a local site, you should have the understanding what's the origin of the route. So we looked at these problems and says it's a problem that needs to be understood, that what is the origin of that prefix, how intelligently I can route around it, I should expect for a good period of time there will be an underlay-overlay interaction, and that should transition to should happen. All transition should happen seamlessly. And if you look at Viptela architecture, again, I've heard people make statements that routing is dead. If routing is dead, internet should be dead. You need to understand how these systems will work intelligently, and there is a brownfield environment. There is have to be, all those complexities have to be well understood to have a very classic interaction between these traditional routed models of MPLS and hybrid SD-WAN models of routing and intelligent application systems.
Right. So there's another question. How would you describe Viptela solution compared to other solutions that are deployed or in the market?
So I don't do vendor criticism. I'll tell you a little bit more about our approach. So there are multiple approaches people are taking. From our perspective, the approach is cloud is not just SaaS. So I'll give you an optimal service into SaaS. The reason people went to MPLS that I had earlier mentioned is a ubiquitous data plane, because that's what my applications were asking for. So if I want to put an optimal service into SaaS, yeah, we have concepts of performance hubs, as I had mentioned. You can put them out there, but there's a lot more to it because I want most dynamic site-to-site connectivity. I want segmentation inside of a network with a single circuit. A very simple use case I had mentioned earlier that I want to have site-to-site connectivity. And that site-to-site connectivity should be only permitted between these two segments. Partner enablement and connectivity. Again, we were working with a very big manufacturing guy. They said, look, we do not deal with our all these work that is done across partners until they've reached a point where the product is finished. So we orchestrate that connectivity. We control that connectivity. We control only those segments that are allowed to connect. We have the visibility of the application, and we give them a full mesh on that setup. They have a whitelisted topologies, and those are the elements they'll connect. So those elements that are allowed to connect across partners, and earlier they were using MPLS circuits. Now they're augmenting it with internet as an alternate path. So again, you just cannot do away with what customers have been utilizing and using. And same with the healthcare use case, that I want these segments to go. I want these imaging applications to be shared in a full mesh. And I should be able to use whatever is the best performing circuit. Whatever I was doing earlier, do not disrupt that. Give me capability over any kind of transport to provide any kind of connectivity. So again, the customer should have the flexibility to decide how they're going to connect versus you deciding how you're going to connect because you're placing certain elements in the network. So I think for larger enterprise environments, these things are table stakes, and this is what they require, that what I want and how I want to connect. You should not change it, augment it, or give me freedom to choose, decide with flexibility what I want to do.
All right. Thank you, Khalid. So this is the end of our webcast. Thank you all for joining this web session. We have the second part of this series targeted for March 16th. You can go to Viptela website to get additional resources, and you can also download the this particular presentation, as well as the VOD is available as well. Thank you all.